I'm Marina Litvinenko. I am a wife of Alexander Litvinenko, my husband. I call him Sasha. 14th of October, 1994, when we married, we didn't want to make any photographs, but a woman from the civilian center said, please, just do it. It would be good memory. And now I'm very happy I have this picture. When I met Sasha Festival, he was a KGB or FSB officer fighting organized crime. It was a very difficult period for Sasha. Criminality was everywhere. And there was a connection between officers of very high rank from FSB and organized crime. This was a very dangerous moment. And Sasha became more and more upset.
И мы не хотим становиться бандитами, мы честные люди, понимаете, честные люди. Я 9 лет или там сколько, 8, боролся с организованной преступностью не для того, чтобы бандитом стать.
When Sasha told me they have a new director and it is Vladimir Putin, I said, and who is this guy? So Sasha went to meet Putin himself. And he explained to Putin the connection between people from the security service and organized crime, drug dealing, all of this kind of criminality. Putin didn't show any interest, and they finished. When Sasha came back, he was worried what might happen to us. I said, and what is next? And he said, actually, they might kill me or maybe arrest it. It was just two options.
For Putin, there are enemies and there are traitors. Enemies is something he can live with, but the traitors is a different, totally different kettle of fish. Betrayal is one thing he absolutely doesn't tolerate. He's a vengeful man.
I've been threatened with murder, I've been threatened with kidnapping. He took over Russia, which was on its knees, and he has dealt with all that, controlled it.
Money is power. There are now new rules of the game.
Putin didn't win, and Putin hates not winning.
Putin doesn't really need to say, I want this person to be killed.
Police are investigating the unexplained death of the controversial Russian businessman Boris Berezovsky. He's been found dead at his home in Berkshire.
At one stage, he was one of Russia's most influential oligarchs. But in the late 90s, he quickly fell out of favor with the Kremlin after becoming critical of Vladimir Putin.
In the Kremlin, there's a new man in charge. 6 months ago, hardly anyone had heard of him. To stay in the Kremlin, Vladimir Putin needs to be a strong man. But he'll also need the political skills of a superman if he's to succeed in turning Russia into a functioning democracy.
Well, I interviewed Mr. Putin a year into his first presidency. He was still new. He was a bit unsure of himself. When he came into the room, you didn't quite notice he'd come in. Because he was new, we were asking him all sorts of different questions. On occasion, I would ask him personal questions like, what books are you reading? What's your daily regime?
Чем вызвано достаточно жесткое патриархальное поведение супругов Путиных на публике? Это истинные отношения господина Путина к роли женщины.
He didn't quite know how to answer.
Ну что ж, это вот у нас такая манера поведения. Кому-то может нравиться, кому-то нет. Я полагаю, что все-таки избирали граждане России на должность президента меня, а не мою супругу.
So he was a new president. He'd never had a public persona, never run for office before. And he wasn't yet comfortable in who he should be and how to handle those questions. You felt a sense of vulnerability.
У меня появилась новая роль. Пиар-представительство. Мы стали создавать его культ.
Я прошу мне помогать, пожалуйста,
наша
Он очень быстро учился. Он летает на вертолете, летает на истребителе, плавает на военном катере. Появился молодой президент или кто-то в образе президента. А я увидел в нем русского слабого человека, который попытался быть сильным.
More than 100 Russian sailors are trapped tonight in a crippled nuclear submarine. The Kursk sank while taking part in an exercise in the Barents Sea. It's lying on the seabed, apparently badly damaged and out of radio contact.
The Kursk was certainly the worst thing that happened to Putin in his first year in office. My naval attaché was in very close contact with the Russian Navy, and as soon as we'd heard that the Kursk went down, he had instructions from the Ministry of Defense in London to go and offer help to the Russian Navy. The answer was, well, thank you very much, we'll get back to you. And they hummed and hawed. It was a very traumatic story, not well handled by Putin. He didn't come straight back to Moscow and take charge of the incident, and a lot of anger built up.
A full week now since the Kursk was sent to the bottom. A Russian admiral has said there is almost no hope of finding any of the 118 crew alive.
There was a window of opportunity where perhaps at least some of the sailors who died could have been saved. And that was a shock to a lot of people in Russia. And to add insult to injury, Putin didn't even leave his holiday home in Sochi, where he was at the time. He continued to enjoy, you know, seaside.
Did eventually come back. He went up and he had meetings with some very angry relatives of the sailors who died.
Для того, чтобы поднять, я вам и говорю ответственно. Я не могу сейчас, знаете, прийти сейчас вам наговорить и объясниться отсюда. Я говорю вам так, как есть. Вот это тяжелая правда, но она правда.
If you are the leader, as Putin was, you don't want to be associated with this bit of bad news.
first thing you did was to tell lies about it and cover it up.
You have to get in Putin's mind. He knows that 2 months before he was nobody. And with the help of television, he became Russia's president. So he already knows what power television has, what kind of weapon it is.
Channel One was controlled by Boris Berezovsky. One of the most influential so-called oligarchs in the 1990s in Russia, and who was actually a major force behind Putin's ascension to power. The first major rift between the two came in the summer of 2000 with the Kursk disaster. Channel One launched into a scathing attack on Vladimir Putin, perhaps the most famous episode of Sergei Durenko's weekly show, when he basically completely destroyed Putin's justifications, line by line.
Ну, думаю, что Путина возмутила, в общем-то, позиция Березовского, которую он занял по поводу Курска. В общем-то, его друг, с которым они, как говорится, вместе этот проект под названием «Президент Путин» делали, вдруг неожиданно начинает его мочить.
Березовский thought, I've helped put this guy in power, I have this media thing, and to an extent... Berezovsky perhaps made the huge mistake of seeing himself as the puppet master and Putin as the puppet. And Putin was determined, and quite understandably as a politician, to show that he was the boss, not the guy who owned the media.
And the same month, in September of 2000, the state recovered full control over Channel One. Berezovsky was out.
Не ж предложили добровольно просто отдать собственность, иначе мы тебя посадим, да? Отдай нам, иначе мы тебя всадим. Ну, как это называется? Ну, сегодня про ОРТ, завтра там про еще что-нибудь, а после завтра про палатку, да? Вот нам не нравится, что ты здесь сидишь в этой палатке, у нас есть свой человек из Кремля, который готов сесть в эту палатку. Отдай палатку, ну.
Shortly after that, Boris Berezovsky, who was living here in London, applied for political asylum because I think he feared being extradited to Russia, and the Russians applied for his extradition. So I had to explain to the Russians that Berezovsky was not coming back to Russia. When a KGB general says to you, we will retaliate if you do not do what we wish, and you absolutely know that under our system and our values and our rule of law, we are not going to do what they wish, then you know there's going to be retaliation.
Мы сидели вдвоем 2.5 часа в президентской библиотеке в Кремле. И он мне говорит, понимаешь, говорит, враг это тот, с кем ты воюешь. Честно, лицом к лицу. Ты воюешь, потом заключаешь мир, там, делишь территорию, торгуешь, потом снова воюешь, но ты знаешь, что он враг, и ты никогда не поворачиваешься к нему спиной. А предатель, говорит он, это человек, который рядом с тобой, воюет на одной стороне, но как только он чувствует твою слабость или отвернется, он тебя ударит в спину. Вот поэтому к предателям никакой пощады. А Березовский для него был предатель. И тогда никакой пощады.
Every time I cross a border, I could be arrested. Every time an unexpected package comes, could be a bomb or poison. I've been threatened with murder. I've been threatened with kidnapping. The Russian government has come repeatedly to the British government to try to have me extradited back to Russia. I'm clearly a targeted individual. I'm very high on their list of enemies. But I was once the largest hedge fund manager in Russia.
Yeah, but there's a possibility of it, or there's a 25% chance?
Russia was run by Boris Yeltsin, who was the president. He had come up with this idea, which was, if we want to go from communism to capitalism, you need to create capitalists. And so they launched something called the Mass Privatization Program. What should have happened was that all people would own a lot of stuff and they would behave like capitalists. But instead, a small group of oligarchs ended up hoovering up all the state assets at a discount. And it had a dramatic effect, a particularly dramatic effect, the moment that Vladimir Putin came to power. Normally, if you're president of the country, you control your government, you control your law enforcement, you control your foreign ministry, etc. But when Putin showed up, all those normal things that a president has and does had been effectively usurped or privatized by the oligarchs. And so his big thing was, we can't let the oligarchs own the country.
Вы знаете, что я с детства занимаюсь спортом, люблю спорт. Вот нас всегда учили, что к любому партнеру, противнику нужно относиться с уважением. Это значит, что всегда нужно исходить из того, что он где-то в чем-то сильнее тебя, где-то может тебя обыграть.
He believes that Judah taught him a lot. And part of the political philosophy is in this asymmetric response. Judah is all about using the weight or the strength of your opponent against him.
Можно быть и нужно быть гибким. Иногда можно и уступить, но только в том случае, если это путь к победе.
When Putin came to power, he essentially sat down with the oligarchs, these figures who had become so obscenely rich in the 1990s, and as a result had basically come to dominate politics. And he made it very clear that a new dawn had broken. They could remain rich, powerful, and free, however, only so long as they understood the new rules of the game.
Вот это государство вы сами и формировали в значительной степени через подконтрольные вам политические и околополитические структуры. Поэтому меньше всего, наверное, нужно кивать на зеркало.
Money is power. Russia's richest people and those who actually run Russian economy all has to be under Putin's personal control.
In other words, they had to stay out of politics. And some oligarchs essentially left the country as a result. But one was Mikhail Khodorkovsky, the richest of them all. Khodorkovsky, whether it's because of his own values, whether it's because he just thought he was too big to take down, continued to be involved in politics. He continued to hold forth. He actually upbraided Putin about corruption. His mistake was to raise it publicly with Putin on camera.
Масштабы коррупции в России оцениваемые экспертами четырех организаций приблизительно одинаковые, в районе 30 миллиардов оценивается долларов. Это 10-12% ВВП.
Мы с вами обсуждали в свое время, да, значит, совсем недавно, что и ваша компания, допустим, у нее были проблемы с уплатой налогов, но как-то эти проблемы возникли. Понимаете? Вот поэтому я возвращаю вам вашу шайбу.
And Khodorkovsky, as far as Putin was concerned, he became not necessarily a threat, but an opportunity. Bringing down Khodorkovsky was an opportunity for Putin to demonstrate to everybody that no one was too big to be taken down and that there were a new set of rules and they'd better learn them fast.
In 2003, Khodorkovsky was on his private jet, and Putin had the jet surrounded by members of the Russian FSB. They boarded the plane, they arrested the richest man in Russia, and they put him on trial.
Если задача
стоит меня выпихнуть из страны или посадить, ну тогда надо сажать, потому что я, конечно, политмигрантом не буду.
It was clearly political. It was only about power. It was simply the robbery orchestrated by the state and Putin himself of one of the most powerful political players at that time.
The Russian oil tycoon Mikhail Khodorkovsky has been sentenced to 9 years in jail. Khodorkovsky, who was once thought to be Russia's richest man, was found guilty of 6 charges of fraud and tax evasion.
Что касается Ходорковского, считаю, что вор должен сидеть в тюрьме.
Now, imagine you're the 17th richest man in Russia, and you see a guy far richer, far smarter, far more powerful than you sitting in a cage. What's your natural reaction? You don't want to sit in that cage yourself. And so one by one by one, the oligarchs go back to Moscow, and they effectively sit down with Putin, and they say, Vladimir, what do we have to do to make sure we don't sit in the cage? You keep your nose out of politics, and everything will be fine.
You cannot take all the power instantly. You need time. And that's what Putin was doing from the very first day when he became Russian president. He started his assault on television, and then the arrest of Khodorkovsky changed it all. Totally, absolutely.
Putin wasn't trying to get rid of the oligarchs. Putin just wanted to become the biggest oligarch himself.
Putin was succeeding because he had got more political power and had a more orderly administration. Chechnya, if you like, was the bit of downside. It was almost impossible to have a constructive discussion with Putin about Chechnya. The moment you raise Chechnya, he gets completely uncontrollably emotional.
Люди устали от нашей расхлябанности, безответственности.
Или сейчас мы удержим, или никогда у нас не будет шансов сохранить страну.
The post-Soviet period was incredibly difficult for Russia. The Soviet Union was falling apart, and Chechnya thought that it could break away as well. A lot of the separatism was waged by Islamist rebels who really wanted to pull away and create a fundamentalist state in Chechnya. And the federal government in Moscow was having a really hard time bringing the Chechen government under control.
Putin was very sensitive to the fact that Russia was being criticized over its tactics in Chechnya and the way that its military and its security forces were behaving there, which was very brutal. Attacks on civilians, allegations of torture and rape and so on.
As a journalist, I've been arrested, detained, I've been taken to places and tortured, and everywhere I went, there was a portrait of Putin looking at me. What Moscow called special operation was practically a war against local population all over the Caucasus. The brutality in which the Russian military dealt with the situation was absolutely mind-blowing. Absolutely zero respect for human life.
Only that on each other, so I can't say, like,
Высочайшую индульгенцию на это беззаконие можно отменить лишь с уходом Путина, безусловно, и его команды.
Anna Politkovskaya was amazing. She believed that as a journalist, everything needs to be reported, no matter what the costs are. She was reporting on the special operations, on the methods that the FSB used against civilians. She was reporting on disappearances of people, the extrajudicial killings of civilians. Her reporting was very uncomfortable to Putin personally, because she was showing exactly what he wanted to hide.
Ты не знаешь, что делать, когда ты вышел дома из подъезда и так далее. Риск, в принципе, является частью нашей профессии. Поэтому мы готовы. То есть мы, вот я считаю, что журналист готов, он должен смотреть на это открытыми глазами и понимать, что это может быть. Не пугаться там, не плакать это сам.
World leaders have been congratulating Vladimir Putin on his sweeping re-election as president of Russia. Election observers criticized the poll, saying it did not meet democratic standards.
This election has highlighted Mr. Putin's desire for control. He has been surrounding himself with men like him, former members of the KGB and military. They now fill half of all posts here at the Kremlin, and their reach is spreading far.
Ну что ж, вы понимаете, а сейчас я, допустим, должен буду принять определенные решения и должен действовать так, как считаю нужным. Я считаю, что абсолютно понятно, что они должны быть приняты для интересов государства. Они должны приниматься вне зависимости от того, вызывают эту положительную либо отрицательную реакцию.
It was not going well for the Russians in Chechnya. Putin ended up doing a deal with the most powerful clan of warlords in Chechnya, the Kadyrov clan, later on headed by Ramzan Kadyrov.
The type of contract he has with Ramzan Kadyrov is that he keeps things quiet in Chechnya. The order in Chechnya is restored. Whatever Kadyrov does to achieve that is not Vladimir Putin's problem. We know that he is the type of leader who can kill his political opponents. We know how his political opponents were murdered. It's documented. It was the most close people to Kadyrov took part in these murders. So we know that this is something Ramzan Kadyrov is capable of doing.
Kadyrov absolutely has a track record of having his enemies, or people even he just vaguely peeved with, murdered in Moscow and, in fact, around the world.
два с половиной часа назад в собственном подъезде убита журналистка Анна Политковская. На месте преступления нашли пистолет и четыре гильзы.
Анну Политковскую называли одним из самых бесстрашных журналистов России. Она никогда не боялась критиковать власть и отстаивать свое мнение.
Anna was murdered on Putin's birthday, October 7. At this point, Putin doesn't really need to give direct orders. He doesn't have to say, I want this person to be killed. The Russian authorities found and named the people who did the actual murder. But what about the people who ordered it? The Russian justice did not name them. Absolutely, and they considered this case closed. But people who knew Anna pointed their fingers at Ramzan Kadyrov.
I told Sasha, it's very bad news. And he couldn't believe it. He was very, very devastated. And he directly said he knows who killed Anna Politkovskaya. And he said it was Vladimir Putin.
My name is Alexander Litvinenko. I am former KGB and FSB office. Здесь прозвучал прямой вопрос, кто убил Аню.
Somebody has asked here directly, who is guilty of Anna's death? Who has killed her?
Я даю прямой ответ. Аню убил господин Путин, президент Российской Федерации.
And I can directly answer you. It is Mr. Putin, the president of the Russian Federation, who killed her.
Да, действительно, эта журналистка была острым критиком действующей власти в России. Но я думаю, что журналисты должны это знать, во всяком случае, эксперты это прекрасно понимают. Степень ее влияния на политическую жизнь в стране, в России, была крайне незначительной.
Что происходит? В 2006 году не где-нибудь, не когда-нибудь, а именно когда Россия председательствует в G8, принимаются вот эти два закона. Кто критикует власть, уравнять его с экстремистом и террористом. И второй закон. Это самый важный. Второй закон, который позволяет российским спецслужбам ликвидировать врагов российского государства, где бы они ни находились. Уже начали они составлять списки врагов российского государства. В этих списках была и Анна Политковская, и я был, и Александр Литвиненко был, и Березовский. Ну, но это был большой длинный список.
Лучше нас никто не знает, как мы можем укреплять собственное государство.
London had become this focus for a whole collection of Russians who had fallen out with Putin or just basically did not like what was happening in Russia under Putin.
London looked like a completely safe place to us. And Sasha made a joke. You should be very relaxed because we are on island, we're under protection. And I was very proud of him. I just saw he was so busy. He was so enthusiastic. And he met many people, new people. And I was really, really happy for him.
So this is a picture at Berezovsky's birthday party. And we have here Ahmed Zakayev, Sasha, myself, and the actor who represented the Queen. And it was great fun. Who is missing in this picture is Andrei Lugovoy, because he was sitting at the same table with us. Lugovoy is a career KGB officer who served in the government security. It's equivalent to American Secret Service.
Я все время вот юбилей Бориса меня сводится к тому, что появление этого человека там. Вот именно. Вот это было начало подготовки покушения на жизнь нашего друга Александра Литвиненко.
Луговой started talking to Sasha about maybe setting up some joint venture. So they had a meeting.
I knew he met Lugovoy. When he came back, everything was just very nice, very quiet. But when I was almost ready to go to sleep, he started to feel very bad, just suddenly. And when he asked me to call for ambulance, I was shaking.
The claims of skullduggery are reminiscent of the Cold War. A Russian dissident poisoned after a meeting in central London and left fighting for his life.
He is getting worse. He has been moved to intensive care unit and he is becoming kind of yellowish, which is an indication of liver problems.
One doctor from cancer unit, he said he looks like his patient after chemotherapy. It was a radioactive material used. It was not a knife, it was not a gun. It was a radioactive material from nuclear station.
What we've had is an unprecedented event in the UK that someone has apparently deliberately been poisoned with a type of radiation.
Let's be open. Litvinenko was granted political asylum and a couple months ago, he became British citizen. It means that it was terror attack from Kremlin against the British on Britain.
If you ingest polonium, it spread through every cell of your body, so it destroys your DNA. You can't eat, you can't drink.
Sasha started to develop all the signs of radioactive poisoning, but he was able to talk.
Sasha said, so what's happening? Where is the story? To make it a front page story, I said, we need a picture.
I was so against to take a picture of him, but Sasha said, no, Marina, we should do this, because people need to see what they did to me.
And that became a real global front page story. He was adamant that this would not have happened without Putin's approval.
Он не является носителем вообще никаких секретов. Все, что он мог сказать негативного в отношении своей службы, где он раньше работал, он же давно сказал. Никакой новизны в его действиях уже быть не могло.
Today, a judge concluded Alexander Litvinenko was killed in an operation by the Russian Security Service, the FSB.
There is a strong probability that his death was ordered by the Russian security service and was probably approved personally by President Putin. Two Russian men have been identified as the killers. They and the Russian government have vehemently denied any involvement.
The murder of Litvinenko was not just about silencing Litvinenko. There were much, much quicker, easier ways of doing that than putting polonium in his tea. This was also about the theatre of murder. This is also about using Litvinenko as an example to the whole so-called Londongrad set of expat and emigre Russians in London and telling them, you may be in London now, but don't think that means you're safe.
Мы встречались не один на один, правда, небольшой группой главных редакторов. Конечно, был вопрос, но он и говорил, что Литвиненко предатель. Но он не знает, кто его убил, да, но он предатель, и все. Собаки – собачья смерть. Но это не мы, но собаки – собачья смерть. Но это не Россия, но собаки – собачья смерть.
The exiled Russian tycoon Boris Berezovsky has been found dead at his Surrey home. At one stage, he was one of Russia's most influential oligarchs. But in the late 90s, he quickly fell out of favor with the Kremlin after becoming critical of the soon-to-be president, Vladimir Putin.
Громкая история последних недель. Смерть в Лондоне Бориса Березовского. У нас много вопросов на эту тему. Давайте прежде всего попросим вас прояснить историю с письмом. Оно было? Березовский писал на это письмо?
Ну, знаете, мне, я вообще не хотел бы говорить на эту тему, но да, он пишет о том, что считает, что совершил много ошибок, нанес ущерб. Просит его простить и дать возможность вернуться на родину.
Еще хочу уточнить все-таки этому важному. Вы ответили?
Нет.
Для Путина все, что касается Березовского, очень болезненно, потому что это разговор о предательстве.
У меня никогда не было с ним никаких отношений близких. Ну, мы были знакомы, разумеется.
Те, кто работал тогда, знают, как они были близки. И ответить надо так. Березовский – это ваш предатель. С большой буквы. Ваш предатель.
The police thinks it's suicide, but the coroner couldn't make it out beyond reasonable doubt. The family thinks it's not suicide. I personally think that he killed himself because he was ill, he was depressed.
А знаете, вот у меня очень много жизни, я близких людей потерял. Когда вы на войне, вы привыкаете к тому, что вы теряете близких людей. А то, что я остался жив, наверное, еще не мой день.
Well, I interviewed Mr. Putin twice. Once in 2001 and again in 2006. And what was most striking was how much he changed in between. By now, Russia had paid off its foreign debts. It was doing very well. And it was the Mr. Putin we all know.
Would there ever be a situation where Russia would use its political power to shut off the gas supplies to Western Europe?
Можно мне вам задать вопрос? Сколько стоит ваше ожерелье? Ну, примерно.
Ну, это очень неожиданный вопрос.
Вы не могли бы мне его продать за 5 копеек?
Как раз, поскольку вы президент России.
Почему Россия должна за бесценок отдавать свое имущество и свои природные ресурсы другим партнерам?
He was presidential, he was confident. If I asked him a difficult question, he turned it round and asked me a question. There had been a complete transformation.
Look at Putin, what's going on over there. I mean, this guy has done, whether you like him or don't like him, he's doing a great job in rebuilding the image of Russia and also rebuilding Russia, period. Forget about image. Vladimir Vladimirovich Putin!
By 2008, the rule of law means basically nothing. The state is now the major player.
By that time, he had under control everything. But there's still one thing that he complies to, this constitutional demand to step down after two consecutive presidential terms.
In many ways, Putin is faced with exactly the same dilemma as any mafia godfather. How do you retire? When everything that you are, everything that you have, and on all your security depends really on your position. He needs someone who will be dependent upon him, who he thinks will be efficient, who will be loyal, and who above all will protect not just him, but Putin's own legacy.
Движение! Только вперед!